welcome to Wachoraji Show. My name is Dan Boats. My guest is Maina Maseeti, all the way from Karen Waterfront. Asante sana kwa kuja, Maina. So tell me about yourself.
Asante Danko. Name is Maina Maseeti. I like making things, creating things in different media. Like I've been doing graphic design, photography, and also using wood, woodwork, carpet.
So which medium do you use?
Here we have, it's a photography, and this is printed on canvas, and then I've done the framing just using simple wood.
Okay.
And that is photography that I have here.
About this one?
This photo I took in Kileleshwa. It's a flower with the sky in the back and frame it with some round pieces of wood.
So you need any paint or photograph?
It's a photograph. And it's printed on canvas.
Okay.
Yes.
So how long have you done art?
Well,
commission.
I've done art for maybe, how many years I say? 30 years, maybe, I would say. I've been doing on and off commission work, some of my own things. So for quite a while.
What about your commission? How price did you go? Your first commission?
That's a long time ago, so it's price is good. Whatever I've been doing, I mean, like I've done from sign writing to making wedding invitations, business cards. So the pricing, people generally pay, it's a good, it's not as good as I see right now, but it's a fair amount of money you can get.
So naweza niambie about your art journey.
My art journey, now it's like I say, I like drawing when I was younger, but you were not really allowed to do it. In fact, I was expressly forbidden from doing any kind of drawing when I was in primary school. And I thought I'd do it in high school. When I went to high school, maybe I thought there would be art and all that. But when I went to high school, there wasn't any art. So I started just going to the library. It was British Council Library when I finished high school. And I learned a lot just from borrowing books, and then I was learning, it was graphic design mostly. I learned about it, and then I came to Nairobi, now learning by working with people. So I used to just volunteer my services to somebody, and we were doing a lot of screen printing that time. At those days, you know, these school uniforms used to be screen printed. People would actually buy them, the schools would buy the thing, and you'd go print the badges. So there was a lot of, you do the graphic designing, changing logos to the sizes, making the screens, then going and printing like 1,000 or more.
In campus?
No, I never went to campus, I just went to high school.
Oh, in high school you do subject related to that?
I didn't do any art.
There was no art and design?
There was technical drawing, which is geometry. But there was no art. I didn't do it in school. I didn't have that opportunity.
Okay, so your art is being inspired by?
Different, well, I like beautiful things. And what I can say is, what I really don't like is maybe showing images of, like you go to Kibera, you start showing people suffering. Because every day you see suffering, so I don't see why I should even put it on. I like to show things that maybe give you a sense of, I like nature, so maybe a sense of the power that is in the natural surroundings, and then also man-made structures like this picture here. This is in fact it's called the dark power. This picture I took in 2013 in Kangemi. And you can see it's ironical because this week we have 5G being rolled out.
Yeah, 5G.
And there's a lot of controversy over it. And here we have, this is 2013, dark power.
And this one, which year?
This is about the same time.
You took when the photo?
In 2013, I have actually have thousands of pictures. I like photography. I'm very, of the things I like doing, I like photography is very high. More than, I'm not so keen on painting, but I have done some paintings. There was this lion project where we had fiberglass lions. being done by Bone Free Foundation about 10 years ago. I think it was in 2009. And I did actually two lions. There were these big fiberglass lions. There were 55 of them. So they got different artists sponsored by a corporate, and then you had a theme and you painted the lion, and then it was fiberglass life-size lion. Then they were displayed for about a month in Nairobi, and then they were auctioned to raise money for lion conservation. So that's actually one of the last few paintings I've ever done.
What about photography in wedding ceremony? Have you done?
I've done mainly for my friends, but I don't really like that kind of photography for a client, because it's very demanding. And these days you have all these people doing the drones and this and that.
Yeah,
so people want some very sophisticated kind of things. So I steer away from that.
And when you are called upon to come to a wedding, friend's wedding?
I do my best. Recently, no. But before there, I started doing photography when you're using a film cameras, which was very technical, because you had to know the kind. I mean, you could not see the picture until you've gone to. You nasema umeenda kuosha picha, then you see it. It's not these days you take, you see, you take, you see. So that's the time I was actually very interested in. That's why I started.
And camera is a self-taught or something that you learn from someone?
I just self-taught. Teach myself. I mean, I read, I experiment. Then you look at other people, ask questions, come back and practically experiment. And then that's how. I mean, when I say self-taught.
Even graphic design also?
Everything.
Okay.
Even the carpentry that I'm doing now, like I said, I'm getting involved in a bit of carpentry and metalwork and the construction of.
Even on YouTube, you have some inspiration?
On YouTube, it's good because you can avoid doing this. Somebody has done something, so before you even experiment on it and take some time and effort, you can actually see somebody go through some stages. So it really saves you a lot of time and effort. So YouTube is a very good resource if you know how to use it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So who motivates you in Kenya to do photography?
Yeah, like I said, my motivation is this guy. I just wake up in the morning and I have so many different kinds of, like, say, my children or my family, the things they are saying or doing. Maybe it puts me into some. Then the kind of different artists that I see, like around here, you see. So I have a lot of motivation. I cannot even point my finger at one.
There are many.
One person you could say that really inspires me is this furniture you see here. It's an old man called Njoroge that I've known him for a very long time. And I was even helping him build his house this past week. And the way he does his work, he's also self-taught. He's very thorough, very particular. And the kind of energy he puts into his whatever he puts his mind into, now he's doing leather work and glass work. So I get motivated by seeing how other art, even you, Danko, when I look at your work and I see the kind of detailing you're doing. So to logo from everybody makes me, it gives me that feeling of, I think let me try this, or let me, whatever I'm doing, let me also put the same energy.
Okay.
So that's what happens.
So challenges you have faced in your art?
Challenges we face, I mean, well, the first one, like I said, since I was not allowed to do art, like I said, I was expressly forbidden, because I drew some pictures when I think I was in class 6. And I was actually forbidden. I was called to the office and I was told you should never draw, because you're going to waste your time and you have better talent. And I was also very good in class. I was in the top 5 always. So they thought art was going to make me my academics suffer. So that was the biggest challenge, acceptance. And then, of course, acceptance from your own family, and then, of course, now resources. If they're not accepting you to do it, they're not going to help you, you know, money to buy paints, money to, you know, like I said, I was using a film camera. It took me a long time to even purchase my own camera. took me a long time even to be able to buy rolls of film. I have still have negatives which I have never processed because I didn't have the money.
Mm.
So acceptance, resources. And then so you're learning, you're something you're also teaching yourself, you don't have the skill. So it's got to be, it's an uphill task because it's only you who is pushing, motivating yourself.
Mm.
Yeah, so these days it's easier because there's more you can see on the internet.
Yeah, internet,
it's
yeah.
easy, you know, to see other people are like-minded.
Mm.
But like I said, 30 years ago, it's a very different story.
Oh, yes. There was no YouTube, people.
Yes, you know. Yes.
So to sell on those years, how it required?
To sell, first, you know, those times, even up to now, to a large extent, you had to meet, you had to be boxed, you had to go into a certain box. You're making curios or stuff that Wazungus like, or, so you had to box yourself in if you wanted to sell. Or you had to know the galleries, of course, the way they are run, they are very, they have their own way of doing things. And you had to meet, because I even went to, which is we call Gallery Watatu, with some of my paintings and drawings, and they did not take it because the work was not bad. They said it's too sophisticated. They want the, what they call primitive art. So it means you'll have to stop doing something a bit sophisticated and go do whatever to please them. So it was a balancing act. So it's now up to you to decide, are you going to give up what you want to do, cater for someone else's tastes? Now me, I didn't agree to cater for other people's tastes. So me ni kanguka pande ya barabara.
They want more detail, aesthetic.
They don't want detail, they don't want sophisticated thing. They want what they call primitive art. Because they were marketing art from Africa as being very simplistic things with simple colors, what people call abstract. So if you come with something that looks a little bit refined, you don't have an audience or you don't have a market for it. I mean, I'm talking about the private galleries which were being run at that time.
Okay. So how do you charge, for example, this one? If
now,
someone wants
this particular one, now what I like to do, I like to just take my own pictures that I like. I print them out and then when I sell them, it's now, this is not commissioned work. So this particular piece is being sold at 50,000. And it's printed on canvas. Now for photography, generally what happens is that since you can print many of them, you try to limit, you make like an edition maybe of 5 prints.
And if someone wants his photography like this and in frame like this, how do you charge?
Yeah, like now this one, I'd say, okay, the frame itself, this framing cost, I'd say 5K, 5,000 shillings, this type of frame. And then I can, if they want just a frame, I can make a frame. But now this particular one, with this image, I'm selling at that price. This one is, this what? This is 3,000 shillings.
3,000.
So that's 3K. You see?
If a picture of someone, like a family on the place.
Now, family cost a bit more. It would be about, I would say, actually, it would be about the same. See, because now what happens now, there's a lot of people are doing family portraits. So you count, this is how you count. Your time to go and sit down and take their pictures. I prefer to actually go to somebody's house and take their pictures at their house. They themselves, they change their clothes. So I'll charge, I'll think how much I spent on a day's work. And then now the printing costs.
So you charge depending on the size?
Yeah, for this one, okay, the size makes the price come down. Now this one, to print a good print, because this print, this is 2013 and it's been hanging and it's not faded. This kind of printing is expensive. This kind of printing, I think, costs about 3 or 4K or probably more for this size right now. When I did it, it must have cost me about 4,000 shillings to just print on canvas. The point is that it's not supposed to fade.
Mm.
There's a lot of digital printing today, but they fade after a year, 6, 8, 9 months, 10 months. So to get one that doesn't fade, now those ones cost more.
Okay.
You see.
So tell me about your future plans.
Future plans are quite big because part of the journey that we've been having is I've also been involved in organizing several actually exhibitions. Now like this one here we're having here, this UM gallery, we started off a small pop and progressed into this UM gallery. So a large part of our plan is there's the gallery activities, there's trainings. There's a lot of trainings we've organized, or we're organizing. There's clay molding, there's trainings on leather work, there's training on painting and drawing, so, and glass work. So these trainings are the ones that we actually think that is the best way to help. Because like for myself, I've been struggling to learn some of these skills. It's very good if people, those who have these skills, can share them out, train others.
So that
we have a bigger pool of people who know more, they have more skills in artistic and craft. So that now the quality of the work is raised up.
Okay.
So that is one of the big plans I have.
Okay.
Yes.
So about encouragement to other artists.
Encouragement, I would say, is, well, you see, people will only accept what you do if they see how you live your life, or rather, if they see the kind of person you are, the kind of the way you behave. If an artist is somebody who is very calm and he seems to have a purpose, a defined purpose. He doesn't look like he's just being taken by the currents this way or that way. And people will respect you and respect the work you do. And then I think also artists, you should try so much. This art industry we have, people are not supporting each other as much, but they are quick to pull each other down.
Yeah.
There's more self-serving interest than serving, you know, the general. Because once everybody is you think about every other person, the whole thing grows and we start benefiting all of us.
Yeah.
That is how I see it. So the encouragement I would say is that this is a much easier time than even 10 years ago to be doing anything artistic. It's much easier. I mean, like the way you go and you do your work and your parents or your family accept somehow that this is a career. Before, it was not a career. Artists were people who were either you're going into drugs or you're lazy or you're a rebel, you don't want to fit in the society. You see, it was not something accepted. You see, so right now it's much easier to have a career in any field of art. So no one should think it's hard as you know, it's actually way much easier.
Yeah,
and the resources are easier to get.
Resources.
You see, so in my time, I mean, to hear what I'm saying, they have actually to physically meet another artist, then they'll tell you a few things. But now you just go on Google and YouTube and you actually hear live from an artist's mouth. As we probably read an article in a newspaper or in a magazine, so and so talk like this, I'm a semi-heavy. So you would not even get the full message. So that's what I'm saying. It's a very great time. What I can say, it's a very great time to be an artist.
So tell about your social media platforms,
sir. Young Mimi.
Facebook.
I'm on the Facebook as Maina Maseeti.
Instagram.
Instagram is Maseeti Maina Photography. And
Twitter.
Twitter, I'm not really on the Twitter, but just those two platforms. That's where you see a lot of my work. And then I'm going to post a bit more. I'm working on putting more of the work digital, I mean posting it out, so that it's accessed. Like I said, from the generation that I am of, we are not so much moved to create hype. I'd rather have a stronger foundation than a lot of hype, a balloon of things that can just burst. So I'm more of, if somebody comes and physically sees my work or goes into my Instagram and moves through those things. So I'm actually taking it very slow on the social media things.
Okay.
That's what I'm doing.
Thanks, Maina, for coming.
Yeah, karibu, danko.
Okay, don't forget to subscribe on my YouTube channel, Danko Arts.